गुड आफ्टरनून फ्रेंड्स, आई नो यू आर वेटिंग फॉर माय लेक्चर. थैंक्स अ लॉट. वी आर लर्निंग रिगार्डिंग बायोकेमिक सिस्टम ऑफ मेडिसिन एंड अ बायो कॉम्बिनेशंस सिंस लॉन्ग टाइम, एंड वी आर डिस्कसिंग द बायो कॉम्बिनेशंस डे बाय डे अलॉन्ग विथ सम क्वेरीज. एवरी डे देर आर फ्यू क्वेरीज and students, practitioners, they ask certain questions. Today also there was one question: sir, is there any role of a biochemic or biocombinations in specifically autoimmune disorders or ankylosing spondylitis? My suggestion is that if you know specifically it is an autoimmune disorder, ankylosing spondylitis, yes, you have to find it out a remedy which covers the whole aspect, because this is more to start with. Every autoimmune condition is psychotic in origin and turns towards the syphilitic miasm. So you have to consider the holistic aspect and you have to find it out a very perfect remedy for treating the ankylosing spondylitis. For symptomatic relief, definitely the biochemics plays very vital role. It depends if the stiffness is much more. Generally, this stiffness is more related with the psychotic entity. Natrum salt plays very vital role. Calcarea fluor and calcarea phos also plays very vital role, along with the caliphosphoricum in such types of cases. So generally, I used to consider the biocombination number 26 in such types of cases as a supportive measure, along with, if needed, a natrum salt. But whenever it is specifically a psychotic miasm, I generally consider the antipsychotic remedy, whatever it may be, which comes out. It might be thuja, it might be medorinum, it might be calcarea silicata. It varies from person to person. Natrum salp, I used to give it in high potency on the basis of homeopathic prescription, not on the biochemic concept, because it is in 6x potency, generally it takes long time to act. And that's why I used to use a supportive measure in the form of a biocombination number 26 either, or 19 either, from case to case, and if needed only the natrum salp. So this was the answer to the first question. And second question, which is most common question of every student and every homeopathic practitioner, that is the, sir, there is a problem in treating the fungal infections and it is too much increased nowadays everywhere. Not only in Mumbai, it is everywhere it is present. And basically this fungal infection is the result of bad hygienic conditions. It is because generally a sweating, a moisture which is there in the environment, and because of which moisture and perspiration, which if gets saturated over there, ultimately attracts the fungus to grow over there, and because of which this ringworm spreads a lot. And what happens whenever the fungus happens to be there, a fungal infection happens to be there, the patient goes to an allopath or he goes to the medical store, he asks for ointment, and it is the antifungal along with steroids, or sometimes antifungal, antibacterial and steroid ointments, they are there in the market and they are used. First time it looks very, very useful. Immediately it disappears for a week or 15 days, and they stop applying that ointment, and it recurs. And when it recurs, it is in aggravated state, and now it never responds to that ointment. When they go to even a skin specialist, the problem lies with them also. They give oral antifungal as well as local antifungal plus steroids in order to get very early result. And nowadays there are very strong and steroids are there, steroid ointments are there. For time being, again, patient settles and feels better, but it recurs again, and when it recurs thereafter, then it is not responding to any line of treatment. And in such types of patient, they returns to homeopath, and the homeopath also gets a problem in treating all those cases because it is already suppressed to such a level. When you have to treat those cases, first important thing is that you have to ask for prior history, because now altered case is there with you. You are not having a pure case of fungal infection. Now it is altered because there are no modalities, there are no sensations, only itching, and it doesn't have a characteristic modality, and that's why it never works. So you have to ask the past history of the same disease, how it was to start with. That sometimes guides you to find it out a perfect remedy on the basis of symptom similarity or on the basis of characteristicness. There is no fixed formula. Some people are using that tellurium is the best remedy for the ringworm. It has been mentioned, but it is not for every case of ringworm will be treated with tellurium. So tellurium is one of the remedy, but there are now multiple. Even Dr. Burnett has said that bacillium is very important, because bacillium covers that miasm. It is the in-between state which is covered. Ringworm state is covered with bacillium. Yes, bacillium you can use, but bacillium not as a on the basis of symptom similarity. If it is on the basis of symptom similarity, then it definitely works. But bacillium intercurrent doses in 30 potency works beautifully. In a weekly or a fortnight doses of 30 potency works beautifully in such types of cases, which brings back again the sometimes original features of the patient, and you can find it out a remedy, and that becomes easy for prescription. Yes, bacillinum I am using in my practice. I am using sorinum, I am using sulfur, I am using graphitis, depending. It varies from person to person. It is not fixed that this is the only remedy I used to use. From biochemic point of view, yes, I am going to discuss all those things. But when you consider this fungus, you must consider the causes behind that. And personal hygiene plays very, very vital role. Second important thing is that as much as possible, they used to use the dry garments. That is more important. It should not consist... It should not consist any moisture. Whatever underwear and undergarments are there, generally they absorb moisture, and moisture remains over there. And that is one of the reasons because of which it gets aggravated. And that's why it is your duty to tell the patient that they should wear undergarments which are purely of a cotton. That is first important thing you have to tell. Second important thing, person attracts the fungus, that is the yes, disease is inside him, but fungus comes from outside. You have to remove that specifically the fungus from that. And if you want to remove the fungus, best solution is there with you, that is the calendula. Calendula mother tincture, calendula ointments, but calendula ointment of SBL only. I am very far for SBL and Medilife. These are two ointments which are very easily, they immediately get absorbed over there, or you can say they get liquidated immediately, and it works. And that's why if you are using a calendula ointment, these are two companies I recommend. Otherwise you can apply directly a calendula mother tincture, and that works in such cases locally, and that removes the fungus. So if you remove this fungus with the help of a calendula, then your work becomes very easy. Then you have to find it out a similimo so that the person further cannot attract that. Then the third important thing, that those persons who used the Chandrakant have given very nice information regarding all those things in the on the group, that how to tackle all those things. But still, I used to ask the patient that if they are doing sedentary work, ask them, I used to ask them to go or at least walk for few steps and then again sit. That is the good thing for them to maintain the health. They have to take care of their perspiration, not with deodorants. This is too important. If they are using deodorants, it blocks the holes over there and it disturbs and it can create a lot of turmoil for the patient. So no, I never ask the patient to use the powder also, because powder itself sometimes disturbs the pores over there. So better aspect is that to ask for a calendula local mother tincture, and with washing with that will be better. That removes that local fungus, and ask to take internal medicine. Now question arises, which are the medicines? Yes, it depends upon from person to person. It again depends upon the sensation, modality, concomitants, all things you have to take into consideration while treating the fungal infections. So there is no fixed formula I'm using, but I'm definitely number of times used to use the bacillinum as an intercurrent that I will suggest to you. Patients get the result when I used to use it on the basis of modalities, and it recovers very fast. Very occasionally few cases where there is a difficulty. Now think about biochemics. Logically, which is the remedy which you can think? The diseases which arises near the water, which we have learned, the remedy is natrum sulfuricum. Natrum sulf and natrum mur, those plays very, very vital role in fungal infections. Natrum sulf specifically covers that aspect very nicely, and that's why it is a fixed entity. He has quoted one thing, that ringworms and obstinacy, it never goes. And so psychotic miasm is so strong. It is psychosyphilitic, the ringworm in between state. And that's why if you want to treat all those things, this miasm, this remedy, natrum sulfuricum, best antipsychotic remedy, even in biochemic doses, works very clearly in such types of cases. Another remedy which is very close to it is again a natrum muriaticum. And natrum mur also covers the similar type of miasm. And that's why natrum mur produces a very typical herpetic eruption. If you will go through that, this word is mentioned everywhere. Herpetics means it is herpetiform, spreading, increasing annularly. Annularly means from sides. It is not yearly. It is annularly means on the margins it goes on increasing, spreading. And that those herpetic eruptions are very typically present in the natrum muriaticum. So these are two important remedies which you have to think about when you are treating fungal infections. If that is irritating the person, you add the caliphosphoricum along with that, because caliphos removes that irritation which is caused because of it. So these are the three remedies I used to suggest to you regarding the skin affection, or specifically the fungal affection. So this is my approach of approaching towards the fungal infections, and generally patient settles with all those things. Then we'll turn, if we are discussing fungal infections, let us discuss first the 20 number, then we'll go towards the 19 number, because 20 number is again a very good combination for the skin affections, skin entities. But which are the contents of this 20 number? Have you looked towards it? There are three important ingredients are there. First is the calcarea fluor. Because we have learned that calcarea fluor has very typical action on the palms and soles, and it produces cracks and fissures over there. And because of which, these cracks and fissures can be healed with the help of a calcarea fluor. So, plantar fasciitis, palmar eczema, this remedy plays very vital role if there are cracks and fissures over there. and the thickness which happens at the palm lever or in the soles, that can be tackled with the help of a calcarea pleura. So that is first constituent of the 20 number. Second important constituent of this 20 number is calcarea sulp, obviously, because calcarea sulp and kali sulp, these are two clothes which are present in this skin affection, because both of them are the remedies for third stage of inflammation. The first part is covered with calcarea sulp, next part is covered with kali sulp, but both of the remedies find their expression on the skin. Calcarea sulp, already we have discussed that it always tries to find it out a vent on the skin in the form of an eruption, and those eruptions oozing a pustular discharge is the calcarea pleura stage, calcarea sulp stage. Kali is more advanced. Kali sulfuricum, the inflammation is of a high grade. It throws away that in necrosed material, discharged material, and that's why it is yellowish greenish discharge which generally happens with the kali sulfuricum. So if you have a case of a fungal infection with a secondary bacterial infection, think about it. This is very important. Secondary bacterial infection, that part you always keep it in your mind. So you have a case of a fungal infection with secondary bacterial infection, means there are pustular discharge, pustules which forms over there, which are spreading all over the body. You must think of this combination, because other two remedies in 20 number are Natrum Moor and Natrum Sulp, already we have discussed. Natrum Moor and Natrum Sulp, they are very important remedy for herpetiform eruptions, for the fungal infections. And that's why if you think in that way, if it is not purely only a fungal, but if it is associated with secondary bacterial infection, 20 is better formula, because it covers all those aspects, Natrum Sulp, Natrum Moor, and along with that the calcarea pleura, calcarea sulp, and a kali sulp. These are the remedies which are there. So when you are thinking about this, you have to understand this concept, and it you apply it, you use it in your practice, and let us see what happens. You can find it out. Yes, it's good solution when secondary bacterial infection with fungal infection is there. But 20 is not only for fungal infection. 20 is for number of conditions. If you consider all those five ingredients, then you can think that any psoriasiform eczema or in lichen planus, you can have this 20 number, because if it is associated with the again the secondary bacterial infection. Natrum Moor itself is very good remedy for psoriasis. Calcarea pleura, which removes the scales from the skin, is again a good remedy in chronic psoriasis when it is related with the palms and sole, plantar psoriasis. Calcarea pleura plays very vital role. And that's why this remedy associated with the fungal infection, the secondary bacterial infection, it plays very vital role in such types of cases. So when you are thinking about the biocombination number 20, see the ingredients over there and you try to find it out the solution in according to it. You have ample skin conditions. You have to, patient comes to you, because there is no treatment for psoriasis, there is no treatment for eczema, there is no treatment for lichen planus. Any chronic skin condition cannot be cured with the allopathy completely. They only palliates, yes, till they are applying the ointments, patients are settled. But as soon as they stop applying the ointments, it recurs back. And in all such types of chronic conditions, when it is associated with the secondary bacterial infection, this combination plays a very vital role. So I never generally prescribe directly 20. It depends on the situation. But whenever this eczema, lichen planus, psoriasis, fungal infection, when it is associated with this secondary bacterial infection, I used to use the biocombination number 20. So this is one important aspect regarding the biocombination number 20 that we have discussed. Now we'll turn towards the most important part, and today's session will be totally on the basis on the aspect of rheumatism, that is 19 number combination. before going into the 19 number combination, we'll understand first the rheumatism aspect very clearly. Generally, what happens, as a homeopath or as a BHMS student, we overlook the clinical aspect of looking towards the rheumatism. We never understand the rheumatism properly, and that's why we fail to treat rheumatic cases. In my practice, I was lucky enough that I have worked with Dr. Nitin Bhagli sir for 2 years in his hospital and worked a lot with the rheumatism, and that's why in my practice I used to treat rheumatism every alternate case or every two cases if there is a rheumatic cases. And I was lucky enough that I have studied under his guidance the details regarding the rheumatism. So whenever patient comes, first important thing, I used to diagnose that patient. I never look immediately starts the treatment. Even today I had a case, and on the posture only I found that he is looking like ankylosing. So I asked him to go for an investigation first, HLA-B 27, because the stiffness was so severe. So when he consulted me 15 days back, he had very, very severe stiffness over there, and he was not able to bend forward or backward. It was absolutely looked like a bamboo spine. And the typical posture which we have seen in the Hutchinson book or Chamberlain's book, the typical posture of ankylosing spondylitis, that was looking or observable. So I asked him to go for HLA-B 27. Today he returned and he showed me report, and it was strongly positive. Now you have to think, if the patient comes to you with ankylosing spondylitis, then your approach should be according to it. It is not simple arthritis which you are treating. It is not osteoarthritis which you are treating. So before treating the rheumatism, you must know what exactly rheumatism is. So rheumatism is a musculoskeletal disorder which expresses in three different types. Basically, there are three important types. The first variety is the inflammatory type of rheumatism. Second variety is the metabolic type of rheumatism, and third important variety is the degenerative type of rheumatism. Unless we differentiate it into three important things, you cannot understand exactly regarding the management. And that's why I used to tell, or I used to teach every student, that you must first differentiate between these three varieties. What is the difference between these three varieties? If we'll go with the, we'll first understand what is exactly the inflammatory variety, what is exactly the metabolic, and what is exactly the degenerative. In inflammatory arthritis, we'll take one example of each. Inflammatory arthritis, common example is rheumatoid arthritis. But there are number of infective arthritis which are present, which comes under the inflammatory. Even autoimmune disorders comes under the inflammatory arthritis. So ankylosing spondylitis is one of it that also gets included in the first variety, that is inflammatory. Metabolic is related with the gout. It is related with the metabolism. So a product of the protein metabolism, it is purine substances which are there and which used to get in quantity in the blood, because either they are not excreted or either their protein is consumed in more quantity. Both things can lead to a increase in purine substances, uric acid in your blood, ultimately getting deposited in the joint and causing the gouty rheumatism. So that is second variety of metabolic disorder. And third variety is the osteoarthritis. Common example is osteoarthritis, degenerative arthritis. But another remedy, another two important diagnosis, if it is happens at the cervical spine, it is cervical spondylosis. If it happens at the lumbar spine, it is called as lumbar spondylosis. Sometimes it is of so severe character that it causes obstruction over there, a stenosis in the lumbar spine, producing lumbar canal stenosis also. The first metacarpophalangeal joint is also a commonest site of the osteoarthritis, because this is the joint we used to use every moment, and that's why it also goes to the osteoarthritic phase, degenerative phase. So these are basically three varieties. Now we'll differentiate, how to differentiate between them. One important thing, if you are considering inflammatory variety, the commonest presentation is inflammation followed by degeneration. So in inflammatory arthritis, there is first inflammation happens, and if it persists for longer time of duration, it ultimately ends in the degeneration. It ultimately leads towards the degenerative changes, early degenerative changes. So inflammation followed by degeneration is characteristic of the inflammatory variety. Metabolic is different. In metabolic, there are three important things. First important is the disturbed metabolism. So deposition followed by inflammation followed by degeneration is present in case of metabolic disorder or gouty rheumatism. And third is the most important is the degeneration, where because of senile changes, because of age advances, there is a degeneration first. Because of degeneration, the in-between cartilages becomes degenerated completely. One bone glides with on the another directly without having an in-between medium, a shock absorber like a cartilage. And because of that sliding, degeneration is followed by an inflammation is the characteristic of degenerative variety. See, there is a difference. So, inflammation followed by degeneration is inflammatory. Deposition followed by inflammation followed by degeneration is gouty. And degeneration followed by inflammation is always a degenerative arthritis. If you are able to understand this concept, then you will understand how to tackle. Now, second point which you have to consider. When these disorders are quite common in particular age, when you think of the inflammatory variety, generally it is the second to third decade, that means between 20 to 30 years of age, this inflammatory variety is quite common. So rheumatoid arthritis generally happens between 20 to 30. It doesn't mean that it never happens earlier or it never happens later, but most common period is 20 to 30 years of age. It is little bit the same period you can get in gouty rheumatism, but in gouty it can be little bit early, even from 15 years of age up to the 40 years of age, gouty rheumatism is quite common, but between 30 to 40 it is much, much more over there. And third variety, which is called as a degenerative variety is always common at the after 40, 50 years of age. Most common is the 50 years of age. So that is first important thing, that when this rheumatism develops, on the basis of that you can differentiate. Now, next point which is important to understand. What is the presentation, so that you can understand them very easily. Patient was not having anything till yesterday, and patient comes to you with typical small joints affection, bilaterally symmetrical. A small joints, it started and they are inflamed, and patient comes to you. This is a rare on incidence, because they go to the rheumatologist or they go to the orthopedicians. But sometimes if you are known that you are treating with homeopathy rheumatism, they can come. There are possibilities now increasing. So if a patient comes with acute presentation with bilaterally symmetrical rheumatism of the small joints which gets affected, this is presentation of a rheumatoid arthritis quite commonly. This is quite common presentation. It doesn't mean that it doesn't affect the large joints. Yes, it can affect the large joints, but generally presentation, it starts from small joints and then goes towards the large joint. Generally, it is bilaterally symmetrical, but very occasionally a monoarthritis or unilateral monoarthritis can be possible. So rheumatoid arthritis presentation, it appears like that. It is a rheumatoid arthritis. It is not a single only articular rheumatism. It involves all systemic systems, and that's why it is also called a systemic disorder. So along with rheumatism, the heart can get affected. It can affect the blood, producing the anemia. Is of a heart, very commonly you can get infective endocarditis. You can get even valvular heart diseases. If it has been suppressed, it leads towards that complication also. And that's why you have it. It has effects on the eyes also, producing inflammation in the eyes. Sometimes even a corneal pathologies also can be developed because of the rheumatism. So it affects every system, and that is very important to understand. Rheumatism, rheumatoid arthritis, autoimmune disorder like ankylosing spondylitis, all those, they are generally are systemic disorders affecting the whole human being. And that's why the presentation itself explains you what type of arthritis is there, when this has been started, and you can find it out. Sometimes you never get such acute case, but sometimes you get a chronic cases of rheumatism in your practice. It is since 10 years patient is having rheumatism, and patient comes to you with typical deformities, that is swan neck deformity or fixed flexion deformities of hands, or there is absolutely LZ deformity of the thumb. These are very typical. Immediately you can find it out, this is the case of the rheumatoid arthritis, a complicated rheumatoid arthritis. Because this fixity happens because pain persists for a longer time of duration, and it tries to suppress the pain, and this person disorder, only the pain disappears but disorder remains over there, inflammation persists, ultimately leads with the fibrosis, and the fusion happens, and number of times such types of deformities develop. So going from psychotic towards the syphilitic miasm, this is characteristic, happens to be there with this inflammatory type of arthritis. So presentation also is very important to understand, and that's why you take the history, in the history ODP, origin, duration and progress, everything is very important with which you can understand rheumatoid arthritis in a proper manner and examine patient clearly. You must examine his pulse, you must examine his blood pressure, you must listen the heart sound. If there is an inquiry in your mind, just ask the patient to take the physician's opinion also, if you are not quite clear regarding those things. Because such types of complications can happen with the patient, or patient can go into a cardiac problems, major cardiac problems in such types of cases. So my suggestion is that when you are handling such types of cases, you should be clearly very clear in understanding the rheumatoid arthritis, ankylosing spondylitis, and you must know what are the investigations should be done, so that you can understand them in a better manner. Generally, what happens that people ask the patient to go for RA test, that is rheumatoid arthritis factor test. And they, if RA positive is there, they call the patient that you are having the rheumatoid arthritis or you are having Rakta Sandhiva. But sometimes it happens that patient comes to you with same presentation and his RA test is negative. And you consider RA is negative, it means that he doesn't have rheumatoid arthritis. It's a wrong understanding, or it is misunderstanding regarding the things. Actually, if this is the condition, it means it is a RA positive rheumatoid arthritis, or if RA negative is there, it is called as RA negative rheumatoid arthritis. And that's why generally the orthopedicians labels or rheumatologist labels zero positive rheumatoid arthritis or zero negative rheumatoid arthritis. Diagnosis is one and same. Then question arises, why to do this test? Even though if it is positive, it is called as rheumatoid arthritis. If it is negative, it is called as rheumatoid arthritis. What is the need? The need is that if it is RA positive rheumatoid arthritis, the prognosis is worst. If it is RA negative rheumatoid arthritis, the prognosis is better as compared to RA positive. Only for that purpose it is useful. Then second, quite common exam, quite common investigations one has to do is CBC ESR. Number of students, number of practitioners never do the ESR. My suggestion is that it increases only 50 rupees in their for the test. So why not to do a ESR? Because in inflammatory arthritis, basically rheumatoid arthritis, systemic lupus erythematosus, in ankylosing spondylitis, this ESR is very, very, very high. Higher the ESR, diagnose the case. Number of times you can think in that direction, patient might have a systemic disorder. And that's why it is too important to do a CBC ESR. So you get in inflammatory arthritis, the ESR is very high. If it is infective, you can get WBC increased. But if it is not infective, it is purely inflammatory, generally WBC are as it is, they are not so much increased. If it is because of some allergic problem, the eosinophils gets aggravated, increased. If the patient is having a tubercular arthritis, again inflammatory variety, ESR is very high along with the monocytosis. Monocytes are increased, lymphocytes are increased. So you can find it out, my patient might have a tubercular arthritis also. So think this is very, very important to do investigation and understand the disease from the clinical point of view so that you can think accordingly in your case. You will ask me, sir, how it is useful for us to treat the patient. Our prescription never depends upon ESR, our prescription never depends upon the WBCs or lymphocytes or monocytes. So what is the use? My dear friends, basically when we are talking with the allopaths, modern medicine people, you must know all those things, very important. Then and then your value will be there with them. Otherwise, no one will going to give you value. If you are thorough enough regarding your things, if you do all those investigations, then you can get a price of it. Number of times the patients came to me with severe backache, and even they came to me from rheumatologists, from the orthopedician, and after looking towards the patient, taking their history, asked them to go for HLA B27 and found to be positive, and I labeled them with ankylosing spondylitis only on the basis of a clinical knowledge. So this is too important to understand. Clinical knowledge gives you exactly the prognosis of the disease. If you understand the patient is suffering from rheumatoid arthritis or ankylosing spondylitis or such infective arthritis, tubercular arthritis, accordingly you can think about prognosis of them. Patient, how much time the patient has to continue with the treatment. These are not the cases which will going to get cured within a day. If it is chronic arthritis, it takes long time, and you have to tell the patient clearly, yes, these patients you have to take a longer time of treatment, a longer time or long duration treatment in such types of cases. So these are the most important thing which we have to look for. So first we have discussed about this rheumatoid arthritis. Number of people ask them to go for x-rays. X-rays will going to show you only the deformities. It will not guide you to differentiate between directly as an inflammatory arthritis. So X-rays are not so much essential in rheumatoid arthritis. They are very useful to differentiate between only the one thing, osteoarthritis and rheumatoid arthritis, or to find it out how much degeneration is there. For that purpose, X-rays are useful. So this is first arthritis which we have discussed, the rheumatoid arthritis. The clinical presentation, generally it starts with an acute and it persists as a chronic, and those cases comes to you in your OPD quite commonly, the chronic rheumatoid arthritis cases. Second important arthritis is the gouty arthritis. We'll turn towards it. Patient comes to you with acute presentation. He was better till yesterday night. In the morning he comes, he wakes up and he started getting very severe pain in great toe, and it is inflamed, all signs of inflammation which are presenting over there, that is the color, color dullard, or all loss of function, pain, everything is present over there. It redness is there, that pain is there, the swelling is there, edema is there, loss of function is there, all things, all. And you put only one question, that is very common, because purine is very close to puran. So puran poli khalli ka, because it contains lot of proteins. And patient looks towards you. How do you know, sir? Because this happens very commonly with the proteins, and proteins from this dal, specifically the harbara dal, tur dal, these are udit dal, these are very important entities which causes acute presentation of the gouty arthritis, and it is very, very acute. To start with, typical acute inflammation, you can see the pain is very, very, very severe character. So patient, if you approach toward them, they ask that don't touch. It is like that. Presentation is very common. Second important thing, very occasionally chronic gouty cases comes. In your practice, you get chronic cases more than acute. If you are developing your practice, but afterwards you can get those acute cases very commonly. Chronic, it becomes fixed, and generally the commonest site is the ball of great toe, but even other joints also gets affected in gouty arthritis. Even sometimes there are tophi which gets deposited over there or around the joints. Typical presentation, nodular presentation, that is uric acid crystals which gets deposited, producing atypical tophi which are characteristically present in this gout. So you have to look for all those things over there to find it out and diagnose the case. If you know, yes, this is gouty rheumatism, accordingly your management changes. That management I will going to discuss after discussing all those three important disorders. But first we'll understand all those disorders. Second important thing which I want to tell you, that in such types of cases, after looking towards the case only, immediately you can find it out whether it is gouty or metabolic, and you can ask the patient directly that to go for investigation. I generally ask the serum uric acid along with CBC-ASR along with urine routine. You will ask me why urine routine. You can find it out that even in urine sometimes the crystals passes. So you can find it out, yes, regarding the things. Second important thing, uric acid, yes, if it is more than 5.5, generally it is considered to be high. And in such types of patient, you get more commonly it is above 7 or 8 or 9. Sometimes in severe cases, you can get 11 also, the uric acid level. And third, why to go for CBC-ASR? CBC-ASR, generally you can get little bit highly increased. Not it is too high like a rheumatoid, but it is around 30-40 ASR is there. And sometimes little bit increase in WBC. But you can, in order to differentiate between the rheumatoid, this is very important investigations, CBC-ASR, and that's why basic investigation, CBC-ASR along with serum uric acid, along with urine routine, this is most common thing which you can do with the patient. So this is second variety, that is the metabolic arthritis which we have learned. My suggestion is that X-rays never plays too much role to find it out. The gouty rheumatism, but to differentiate you can go for X-ray, but I never advise the patient, because if it is clinically presentable that it is gouty, I never ask such type of things in practice. But for last variety, I used to tell them to go for X-ray. So this is first important thing which you have to look for. Now we'll turn towards the third variety, that is the osteoarthritis or degenerative arthritis. Already we have discussed that it is a degenerative arthritis which happens to be there at the senility, more than 50 years of age or advanced age generally suffers from it. Nowadays, you can get those cases early in your practice. Because people are not doing the regular activities. They are sedentary workers, they are sitting in one places, their muscles, their bones doesn't carry a strength, and early in their life they develop this degeneration, and you get very commonly the cervical spondylosis over there, because everyone is sitting in front of the computers, desktops, mobiles always like this, and this produces cervical spondylosis very commonly. Mobile is the worst thing. If you want to see mobile, you should be looking toward the mobile directly, face to face, and that is the best position which prevents the cervical spondylosis. Second important is the lumbar spondylosis degeneration, which is common because of continuous sitting, or some people who used to do a very high heavy work in the farm, they also get very clearly this osteoarthritis or lumbar spondylosis or cervical spondylosis. Because of heavy work they carry on their head, or they lift very heavy work, heavy load, and that, sorry, there was a disturbance over. We'll continue. Are you getting my voice? Just answer, because it was disconnected all of a sudden. Yes, okay, we'll continue with it. So the people who used to work in farm and doing hard work, or those who are really hard workers, they generally suffer from this type of arthritis, osteoarthritis. The commonest site which happens to be there is the knees. So osteoarthritis of the knees is most common area which gets affected, because it is weight-bearing joint. Second important joint which is there, which gets affected, is the ankles, because it also carries the weight. And third important joint which gets affected is the hip joints. These are commonest joints where you can get the osteoarthritis. It might be unilateral, it might be bilateral, but generally it is unilateral. Generally it is monoarthritis. In rheumatoid arthritis, we have learned that it is generally a polyarthritis. Here it is monoarthritis. Even gout, it is generally either a monoarthritis, either a polyarthritis. But osteoarthritis, to start with, is generally a monoarthritis, one of the knees which gets affected, and later on gets another joint which gets affected. So osteoarthritis, commonest site is the knees. Again, one more thing common, which is a practical hint. People talks in Marathi, doctor, gudga dukto, doyala dukto, doyala dukto, gudgyacha. Gudgyacha, doyala, there is a lot of question which arises in students' mind. The medial side of the knee joint is, in layman term, is called as a doyala. It is called as an eye of the knee joint. And manun, that is very important thing, one must not forget this sentence, that it generally affects the medial side of the joint. There is a typical pain which is persistent, and then whole joint gets affected. Second important thing, to start with, it only starts with pain aggravated because of walking. Whenever patient takes rest, patient feels better. All those things are quite common with this arthritis. And exactly opposite you can get in rheumatoid. Rheumatoid, they become stiff, and to start with they feel painful, but with continued walking they feel better because the stiffness disappears. But in osteoarthritis, opposite which you can get. Here the pains generally gets aggravated afterwards because of this degeneration, and with walking, with movement, the pains gets aggravated. So osteoarthritis generally happens in the old age, and it happens in all those joints. And one more thing that I have told you, that is the first metacarpophalangeal joint, that is again a commonest site of osteoarthritis. So this is first important thing which we have to differentiate. Second important thing, in clinically when you are examining, you always examine every joint. And how to examine joint is very nicely given in Hutchinson's book or Clinical Das. Examine, you if you are examining knee, the keep your left hand on the knee if you are right handed, and just keep it just touching the right knee or left knee and bend that joint, and you will immediately feel a typical crackling which is felt to your hands. It suggests that patient is having osteoarthritis. It is degeneration which has happened over there, and that's why it is producing typical sound or which touches to your hands as a thrill. So that also you have to understand, you have to examine. Examination plays very vital role. If you are examining this and you find it out, then examine both the knees. And when you examine both the knees in this way, you can find it out the degenerative processes over there. And patient always tells you, Doctor, gudge vachtat. There is sound coming from the knees. That is the commonest sentence. Crackling which happens in the joints because of osteoarthritis in old age. And that is one more feature which is quite common with the patient. So examination of these joints, clinical examination, plays very vital role. If you'll find that the edema, there is marked edema over the knee joint, then you do a patellar tap test. You fix the patella with your left hand and just press with the right hand the patella, and it flows, swims over there, and it immediately shows you that there is an effusion in the joint. See, this guides you towards the treatment at the end. You will say, how can it be? Then you have to think which remedy which you are going to think when there is an effusion in the joint. It is whenever effusion is there, generally it is serous effusion, serous membrane which secretes a lot, and serous effusion is there. Then you can think about the bryony also. Then you can think calimiraticum, which I have discussed while discussing the biochemic remedies. So accordingly, if you use such type of logic while practicing, definitely it helps. So all those clinical examinations are very much necessary to understand exactly what may be the pathology. And that guides you to find it out exact location of the pathology, exact tissue which is getting affected, and accordingly the remedies in your mind. When degenerative arthritis is there, basically it is the degeneration of the cartilages happens. Now, you can think about that, which is the remedy which is having direct action on the cartilages very commonly. And it is a Ruta. Why not to use Ruta? I am using in Ruta in high potency, 10M potency in repeated doses, and patient explains that, Doctor, 15 days back it was worst. Now I am much more comfortable. Why not to think in that way? Yes, kaliiodam is a remedy, but kaliiodam is a remedy good for rheumatism, inflammatory arthritis. It is very important remedy for inflammatory arthritis. It is not for degenerative arthritis which you can think over there. So, how to examine a patient and how to understand a patient plays a very vital role. Even we never learn how to examine a neck of the patient. So, you generally, in my observation, homeopaths never examine the patient for backache. I used to do whole examination, and this has been taught by my guru, Dr. Nitin Bhagli sir. He taught me each and every examination, how to do a clinical examination, how to fix the head of the person and look for the cervical spine, and then examine the trapezius to differentiate or come to a diagnosis. Every examination plays very vital role. Even if a patient comes to you with this neck pain and generally labeled as a cervical spondylosis, but if you are very thorough with the clinical knowledge, if the patient is telling you that, Doctor, I am getting the off and on pain in my right hand, but there is one more thing I want to tell you, that there is a severe spasm is there, and sometimes it happens, I feel very hot sometimes I feel coldness over there in my upper extremity. It should touch your mind that patient might have a cervical rip, or patient might have a scalenus anticus syndrome. You examine that patient, there is one test explained in your ESTAS, it is called as Addison test, And if you do ads and tests, ask the patient to sit, keep his hand in your you keep your hand over his radial pulse, ask to take it back side and ask to turn toward the same side, towards same corner, exactly at the same level, and ask him to breath, hold the breath. Immediately that patient's pulse is obliterated, it indicates patient is having cervical rib. So you must be very, very thorough regarding all those things. If you are able to understand this, ask the patient to go for an X-ray of a cervical spine, AP and lateral, and you can locate there might be a cervical rib, and immediately you can get the basis what you are treating is cervical rib, and then your management depends upon that. So all those things plays very vital role in order to understand the patient, and accordingly homeopathic management depends. If you are examining backache with a sciatica, you must know which are the tests which diagnose the sciatica. The two important tests I used to do, it is called a straight leg raising test, SLR. If the patient is not able to lift the leg above 45 degrees, and if patient is having very severe pain, he cries or shrieks with the pain, it indicates that patient is having disc prolapse intervertebral disc. Your diagnosis is very clear, your treatment is very clear at that time. And that's why it is too important to diagnose the case when you are treating such types of cases. Or you ask the patient to lie on abdomen tummy and ask him or hold his leg and lift it over. That is called as femoral root stress test. And this FRST, if it is positive, it again indicates that nerve root is getting affected over there, and femoral root is getting affected. It itself indicates that patient is having a sciatica problem, or there is prolapse intervertebral disc. There is a infiltrated disc which is there causing a pressure. So to diagnose all those things is a very essential entity. If you are able to diagnose accordingly, your homeopathic management varies, and then you have to come to a conclusion of a treatment. Number of times those cases of a lumbar disc prolapse, they are sent to orthopedicians and they operate and patient never settles. You can treat those patients with homeopathy with 100% results, even if there is a problem with the meniscus tear or sometimes with the ligament tears in the knees. You can treat those cases with homeopathy, with proper homeopathic management, and complete cure. Number of homeopaths, they consider this is mechanical problem and cannot be get treated with homeopathy and it requires surgical intervention. I suggest it is not so. I have treated ample cases of disc prolapse with homeopathy, with complete cure, or even lumbar canal stenosis, treated number of lumbar canal stenosis with proper homeopathic management. But for that purpose, you must know exactly the diagnosis of them. And that's why I always suggest to every student in my OPD that they should go for clinical understanding of the case. Read the Hutchinson, read the Esdas, understand all the tests and examine the patient, so that you can accordingly apply the medicines. So this is what regarding the differentiation between these things. Basically, when you are asking the patient to go for a knee X-ray to rule out the osteoarthritis, what happens? We never look towards the things. We ask X-ray AP lateral knees, which will not guide you anywhere. When you are asking the patient for the confirmation of osteoarthritis, you have to label that it should be a standing X-ray of the knee AP lateral. in standing position only they can touch, they, you can find it out, they are touching to each other, not having a meniscus in between. In lying down position, the gap looks normal. You cannot diagnose. You must know exactly what X-ray should be advised. That knowledge should be there with us. And this knowledge is not there with our homeopaths, and that's why we are criticized every time. My suggestion again is that you must understand, you must take this knowledge from the practitioners, from the students, or those who are having this clinical knowledge. You must know it properly. So now, if you are doing cervical spine X-ray, ask them cervical spine epilateral, that is very important. If you are asking that patient, if you are considering that there might be a cervical lumbar spondylosis, you always do, it's better that lumbosacral spine instead of just telling the patient lumbar spine, so that you can differentiate the pathology both at the lumbar level or as well as sacral level. If it is inflammatory arthritis, you can see the changes at the sacroiliac joint, the inflammation over there in such types of cases. And that's why lumbosacral spine epilateral is again very important to diagnose the thing. So these are the basic investigations in such types of cases. There are much more investigations you can do. Then nowadays we have a CT scan or lumbar myelography. Nowadays no one goes for lumbar myelogram because MRI is available, and this MRI, magnetic resonance imaging, gives you very clear picture about these joints, and specifically the spine when you are thinking. Even MRI of the knee guides you exactly regarding the things, and you can treat them with homeopathy very properly. So you can label what you are treating, and accordingly you can think with the help of that. I think we'll stop over here, because since 1 hour I'm discussing regarding all those three things, there are patients waiting over there. Tomorrow we'll continue with this rheumatism formula, biocombination, along with homeopathic management of rheumatism. So ultimately we have to understand on the basis of this clinical knowledge. My suggestion today, you go and read all those varieties of arthritis. Open the Davidson's book, you can get over there. Open the surgery book to find it out, all those things. And you can go and learn that, and then in tomorrow's lecture I will explain exactly the homeopathic management in all such disorders, along with the role of biocombination 19 or 17 or 23 or 26 in such types of cases. So thank you very much attending the session, and I'm very much happy that you are daily you are present over there without missing a single lecture. It gives me more stimulation to come again and discuss the things with you. Thanks very nice for your presenting, and be there, learn homeopathy in this way. Ask your students and ask your colleagues to join our this movement of homeopathy, so that everyone get acknowledged regarding all those things in practice. I will ask you to tell them regarding our channel, YouTube channel, subscribe the channel, and watch the videos, so that you will get very much information over there. Thanks a lot. We'll meet tomorrow at the same time with the next same biocombination and rheumatism.